KCSM, Teo, San Francisco, Oakland, San Jose at 91.1 FM, in Sonoma at 90.7 FM, and live on the web at kcsm.org, the Bay Area's jazz station.
Welcome out to the Desert Island for a Friday. I'm Elisa Clancy. Our pianist-composer castaway today was born in Cincinnati, Ohio, June 21st, 1950. And he loved playing the piano. He started lessons at 7. After leaving home, he got on a tour as Brenda Lee's pianist. And after that, he lighted in Boston, where he studied composition with George Russell and David Amram, and piano with the legendary Madame Chaloff. During the 70s and 80s, he supported himself through music out here in the Bay Area, playing Latin jazz, leading his own groups, and playing with Bobby McFerrin, Babatunde Lea, Jackie Ryan, and others. In 1981, Jackie Ryan asked him to go for a long gig on Maui, and that led to his installation as entertainment director at the Royal Lahaina, not a bad gig. After a wrist fracture in the mid-80s put his musical career on hold, he went back to school. First at UC Irvine, and then to the UCLA Law School, where he was editor of the UCLA Law Review. He began a legal career in 1992 and is now a California Deputy Attorney General in civil rights enforcement. In 2005, after having been off the scene for 20 years, he re-entered the world of music, and he may have to quit that day job. He sounds great. He's Dave Bass. Well, you must have learned something playing in all those Latin bands, because this is a great version of Caravan.
Well, thanks so much.
Yeah. Dave Bass, thank you for coming in live. I love live ones.
Me too.
You get to come into the lair down here.
The inner sanctum.
The inner sanctum, yeah. Tell me your story again. I mean, I mentioned it in the open, but, you know, you went to law school.
Yeah, well,
You always like, have an like interest you, in like, that, yeah?
No, not at all, not at all. and in fact, even though my dad is an attorney, I used to always joke around that it would be the last thing I ever did.
Yeah, forget it.
after having played music for and been very lucky to make a pretty good living at it, you know, which as everyone knows involves some luck. I did pretty well, but I fractured my wrist. I had a young daughter.
Yeah,
and I was an independent contractor. I didn't have health insurance. Yeah. So as I'm sitting there with a cast on my wrist, I just had some hard thinking to do.
Yeah.
I was in my 30s, and it was like, well, what do I do now? And it was like the doctors, well, maybe it'll heal. You know, it's going to heal, but whether you can play like the way you used to,
yeah,
we can't tell. And I just said, okay, I got to do something else. And I always, especially at that time in my life, I like to argue a lot. And I loved to read, and I just thought, well, I know I'll become a lawyer. And to the chagrin of my girlfriend Nancy, I didn't even know I had to get a BA first to go to law school.
Well, I'm smart enough to go call them up. And
yeah, exactly. That's just what I thought. Exactly. I said, I just call them, go to law school. They said, well, where's your BA? I don't have a BA. I was like, oh.
You know, well, so, if you were the editor of the Law Review, I think you must have chosen correctly.
Well, I was in Southern California at the time, so I went to a community college so I got my BA in 3 years, yeah. Doing the community college in between, went to UC Irvine, and then went to law school, and I loved it. It was really fun, and it was actually for me personally, it was a nice change from the career of music because it was more of a meritocracy. Mm-hmm. You know, music, there's lots of folks who are much, much more talented than I who, are scuffling. And they just they can't really make the living they deserve to be making at music because there's so much randomness involved in it.
Yeah.
Whereas the law, involves creativity, but not nearly as much. And so it's pretty structured. And if you work hard, you learn your changes, you cop Bud Powell solos, you do all that stuff that you do in music, they say, oh yeah, well, you're on the Law Review now. You get, and law firms want to hire you. And so it felt really good to have the sort of hard work that I saw, all my comrades in music be doing, just pay off in a much more literal and straightforward way than it did in music. But
yeah, and it could support your music career.
Well, I had, but I, you know, it's
if
funny.
You thought you were gonna,
I had no. It wasn't as if I got so into the law at first that it wasn't the case that I was always nurturing this dream to go back.
Yeah.
I was done. I was really done with music. I really, I'd still play for myself, and I'd play for friends when they come over, but I didn't play with any other musicians. And of course, I ended up settling in Sacramento, where I had never lived before. So I didn't have any musical connections there.
Yeah.
So I just didn't have anything with music. And then, about 6 years ago now, I was going through a soul searching period, for myself. I'll leave it at that. And, whereas I had, up till then, always rejected requests to take a gig or to play at a party. Hey, you used to play piano, didn't you? There's a piano, and I say no, I'd always beg off. And this one time, because I was going through this soul searching period, I went, okay, I'll play. And it turned out there was another band there, an R&B band. It was their break, and this cat wanted me to. He was running the party. When we play in the intermission,
sure.
And so I said okay. And the bass player from the R&B band came up to me and said, "Oh, can I play some jazz with you?" And I was like, being snotty, I said, "Oh, you play jazz?" Because I had just turned and play R&B. He goes, "Yeah, yeah." And he turned out to be a really good jazz bass player, and had these jam sessions he invited me to. And I started playing again, and it was
there. You go.
The monster awoke,
yep.
And.
The monster awoke.
Yeah.
That's right.
And so, one of my old buddies had been Babatunde.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out he was doing a gig up in Sacramento. So I just went to the gig. And, of course, I knew it was him. So the 30 years that had passed.
He didn't know it was you.
exactly. So he sees this weird white cat walking up to him.
Going, man, how are you?
And he's like trying to make the connection. He can't, And but and that was that, and he wanted to said we should do a CD, and we put the CD together, and I was incredibly lucky again. It hit number two on the national jazz charts last year, and I'm back and trying to straddle both worlds right now.
Yeah, why civil rights? You went to civil rights when you could do music licensing law, or
Well, initially I did think I'd want to go into like the law aspect of music, but it was pretty boring. I mean, it turns out that it's mostly contract law.
I know.
It's mostly just like reading these long, the only ways you're going to make money is when you're doing, Britney Spears music,
Right.
you know.
The big pop stars.
Yeah, I mean, Ernie Watts and Babatunde, you know, most of the guys, I mean, even people who are really successful in jazz, I mean, you're not going to make a living at law working that side of it. At least that's how I saw it at the time. Yeah. So, anyway, that was that.
Dave Bass is our guest out on the desert island. Why don't you set up this first piece of music that you picked?
One of my favorite pianists of all time has been Paul Blay, who's done so much. And there's so many, he's had such a long and varied career that I was hard-pressed to pick I wanted to do. And this is I think this is probably the best piano solo I have ever heard in my life on a standard. It's All the Things You Are. It's from a CD of Sonny Rollins called Sonny Me Talk. So it's Sonny Rollins and Coleman Hawkins, and it just happens to be Paul Blay playing in this. And so we're gonna come in at the very end of Coleman Hawkins' solo on All the Things You Are, and then just listen to Paul's solo. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, that stuff will make you cry.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so, and when Bill Evans is, when he's playing that, it's he's hearing the lyric. You're hearing the my foolish heart, you know. You're hearing it. It's gorgeous.
I'm with you.
Dave Bass is our guest out on the Desert Island. So we put together a set, or you did. You're a great programmer. I'm going to hire you. Put together a set of Paul Blay and Bill
Evans
together.
So it's three cuts here. And the first one was a 1963 cut where Paul's exploding a standard, right? All these are, I mean,
he's doing the little wash stuff that he used to do on the, you know, crunchy.
Yeah, and following the changes but exploding them in just this incredible way. And then the next cut we heard, which was
recorded from that George Russell.
It was actually recorded a couple years earlier than that in 59, and it's a George Russell piece with Bill Evans and Paul Blay trading. They're not trading fours, but they're just playing off each other in a song called The Lydiate from Jazz in the Space Age.
Yeah.
And I was lucky enough to take lessons with George Russell back in the day.
Well, he was Cincinnati born, just like you, right?
He was Cincinnati born. And I took lessons when I was in Boston. And the first thing he did when you'd go in for a lesson, I mean, this is back in the day, you know, you bought this little spiral notebook from him.
That had his
The
Lydian
chromatic
concept,
right? And the first thing he'd do, he'd sit at the piano and pound every note from C to C. And he'd say, you know, just the white keys.
Yeah.
And then he'd do it, but instead of with an F, he'd do it with an F sharp. And he goes, you hear the difference between those? And his whole thing was that if you just play the C major scale with an F natural in it, it's unresolved because the F is the seventh in the dominant chord and wants to take you somewhere else, right?
Yeah.
And he says, but the F sharp is it rests and neutral, and that's the Lydian mode, of course, a C major scale with an F sharp instead of an F. And he's a very charming man, and obviously very super intelligent and a whole new approach to music. So I put that one on second, the Jazz in the Space Age. That's 1960. I mean, great. You hear some of his big band writing there. It's just extraordinary. And then he has, you know, what I think at the time were the two most happening pianists on the scene in 59. Paul Blay, who's really going left, and Bill Evans, who had already done Kind of Blue. And as the album says, everybody was digging Bill Evans then. And he has him in the Lydian thing, and that song was called The Lydiate.
Yeah.
And
Bill's right there with Paul, you know?
Bill is right there with Paul. He's copping Paul's stuff, and Paul tells the story like he was scared he was going to lose gigs because Bill could cop it. But then we heard what Bill did a few years later on My Foolish Heart, and it was just a...
And Paul breathed a sigh of relief.
Paul was really happy. I mean, he tells the story that it was like, oh my God, at least I had some gigs I could get now, right? So I just think it's and just for the record, I mean, that version of My Foolish Heart, which is very famous, he's playing an A. I mean, he's like a lot of pianists, realize that different keys have different feels and sounds, and the standard key for Foolish Heart is, of course, B flat, and that's where almost everybody plays it except singers. But he's playing it in A, and he's only playing two choruses, and he's playing very simple, but as you said, Elisa.
But you're hearing the lyric.
The emotion is so concentrated and powerful that in those two, and he's not playing a lot of fancy stuff, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm.
It's very straightforward, but if you surrender to that, to his playing there, it'll make you cry.
It will. Dave Bass is our guest out on the Desert Island today. Where are we going next, Dave? Oh,
well,
Bud
another
Powell.
One of my favorite pianists, Bud Powell. Now, in 2.5 minutes in this Tempest Fugue, Bud will exhaust you. Here he is.
Thank you.
The Bay Area's jazz station, KCSM, Desert Island Castaway today, Dave Bass. Dave, you get the brilliant award today. Brilliant.
Well, you know, I'm just leaning on the real brilliance. I mean, that was Lenny
Tristano
doing his version of All of Me.
We could sing it. We were finding it.
We were singing it, you know. But, of course, he starts on the ninth bar. So you... And he starts with exactly. It sounds like a figure that would begin a song. So all your bearings are gone. But... And before that, we heard, of course, Art Tatum.
Lenny calls that lineup, by the way.
Yeah,
lineup.
Right. That's right. And it's like when he was manipulating tapes. So here's this blind cat back in the day of reel to reels, and he's like sitting there and manipulating, you know, tapes. And you know, because I think what he did is record the bass and the drums first,
mm-hmm.
and then just work out his little variations.
Because he was a gearhead, too. You know, he was...
that's exactly right.
And all kinds of other things, but a fabulous pianist.
And that's from 55. Then the two before that were both from 1949, both Bud Powell and Art Tatum, who, in an analog to Bill Evans and Paul Blais in the 60s, in 1949, I think, were the two cats who were happening in different ways. And... Bud Powell's Tempest Fugits, it's 2.5 minutes, and it's just hard to imagine more music packed into that. He's just on fire. And as Michael Berman said, everybody knows that by the time he was on Verve, which is where this was, because of the shock therapy he had undergone and stuff, mm-hmm. he had sort of lost it. But I think that is as the law says, demonstrative evidence that that's untrue.
Ah, very good, Dave.
What can you say about Tatum? I mean, that Yesterday's and all those alternate chords and all those weird dissonances he's playing syncopated under the tune. You know, I mean, he, as every pianist who listens says, it almost makes you want to give up, because really you can't do that. I mean, Oscar comes kind of close,
yeah,
but he don't make it, and and it's and everybody else falls way even further behind, but it's still for me anyway a huge inspiration.
Yeah.
I want to switch. We're going to play a couple classical things because I'm not a great classical pianist, but I love playing it, and it's I love listening to it. And my all-time favorite pianist is Glenn Gould. And in 1955, I think he was probably about 19 years old or something.
Yeah, the Goldberg Variations.
And
yeah.
he played, and the Goldberg Variations are, it's like a jazz tune. We're going to play the aria first and then two variations. The aria is 32 bars long, and it's sort of like, it's almost all 1-4-5. There's a 3 dominant going to the relative minor, and that's it. It's like a standard. And then you hear, it's in G, for those listening who have perfect pitch. And when you hear the variations, it's just those 32 bars. And this is Glenn Gould just blowing my mind.
Thank you.
That's crazy good.
Yeah, that is crazy good.
I don't think we've ever had Petrushka out on the desert island. But
well, you know,
Stravinsky.
All jazz cats that I know love Stravinsky. But when I hear Petrushka, you know, without all the gorgeous, colorful orchestration, just on
just
the piano.
Just pared down for it, yeah.
It for me, I'm able to hear musically what's really going on more. It's very jazzy. I mean, the rhythmically, you know, he's popping the 2 and 4 a lot, and it's just great. And of course, the playing by Maurizio Pollini is virtuosic. I mean,
yeah.
It's just scary. And Glenn Gould before that's a different sort of virtuosity. It's more linear, more like Lenny. I mean, Glenn Gould's
Lenny
more
Tristano,
like Lenny.
That, yeah.
It's all linear, very precise, and Pollini doing the Stravinsky is more like Tatum. It's just sort of this epic playing, and they're just wonderful, and that sort of music is also a big part of my life.
Yeah, did Madame Chaloff have you do listening a lot? Did she make you?
She did not.
She was something else.
After we talked a little about her, and she's, you know, was a very important part of my musical life, and I still go back to that a lot. And essentially, after the very first lesson where you'd play what you thought was like your stuff, right, and she'd sort of listen. And then after that, you never really got past one note. Because it was never, you were never playing the note correctly. Your wrist was too heavy. One of her big things, as I was saying before, was that she wanted you to bring the energy through your whole body into the piano, but that your arm had to be sort of a...
light as a feather.
Light as a feather.
Yeah, well,
that's exactly right. Light as a feather. She'd hold your wrist, I mean, she'd hold her hand under your wrist while you were playing, and it was like she had her gauge, and you were always too heavy. I mean, invariably, it was you were always too heavy. So it never got to the point where, you know, you'd work on repertoire or anything like that. It was all, at least for me, maybe
yeah,
just
because
I was...
Yeah, but you know what? She wanted you to first be in your body. Absolutely. You can't speak yourself or be your authentic self on an instrument unless you're in your body completely.
Well right. Put.
That was really what she wanted.
I think well put.
That's funny. Yeah, and have play one note over and over and get the color on the note and all of that. So.
Yeah.
Dave Bass is our guest out on the desert island. Speaking of light as a feather, we're going to Chick-Corea and Return to Forever. Tell me about this piece and why you want this on.
When I really came into my own in jazz in the very early 70s, my main men were Chick and Keith Jarrett. And... both those pianists have long, heroic careers where they've moved through all kinds of styles and all sorts of playing. And even though Chick had already done a lot of famous things before this 1972 recording, Light as a Feather, it's still remarkable to me. It was very influential on me at the time. He was playing electric piano. He was playing Rhodes. And the rap on the Rhodes then was like, oh, you know, you can't really, you can't really be your own voice on it. And I think, again, this puts the lie to that. And it's a very short little tune, Captain Marvel. And again, just out of the box, the whole band is on fire.
Oh,
To Korea and Return to Forever, Captain Marvel, 1972 or 73, something like that. Boy, he really got into that. And you're right. You're right. He could do himself. He could be Chick with even on electric piano.
Even too. On electric piano. A lot of people would argue that, you lose your...
Flush it. Yeah, I got to forget the electric piano.
Chick made it a different voice because, of course, he plays acoustic piano beautifully. But this is on fire. And again, the interaction in the band.
Stanley Clarke, man. Joe Farrell, yeah.
And Ayerto, who's, you know, I don't think was really a trap player at that point. He was really just a percussionist, but because he was a genius of rhythm, his drumming is just on fire and lights the whole band up. I mean,
it's great stuff.
It's great stuff.
Dave Bass is our guest out on the desert island today. Dave keeps an office up in Sacramento, but he has a website, DaveBassMusic.com. You can go there, and they can get your music. And you've got this new thing out, too, right?
I got a CD.
The Latin jazz thing.
Well, yeah, there's a couple different things.
La Descarga.
La Descarga is an Afro-Cuban jazz group up in Sacramento. Great band. That we first heard was Caravan. Mm-hmm. That's Harold Muniz on timbales, Bea Muniz on conga, and Dominic Garcia on bass and me on piano. We're going to be at the Sac Jazz Festival this year, Memorial Day weekend.
Yeah.
And you can go to the website and find out about that.
Dave Bass Music. You get to take a book with you, Dave. What do you want to read?
The book I would take with me would be The Collected Poems of Wallace Stevens.
Oh.
And at one point, I thought about reading Peter Quince at the keyboard from that, but I decided against it. But it's got a beautiful line in about it, comparing the music that your fingers make on the keyboard that people then hear with the music that your loved one makes on your heart that you hear. And it's Peter Quince, of course, is the rustic from Midsummer Night's Dream. So it's sort of Wallace Stevens like mocking himself as, you know, not really that hip, but it's I love Wallace Stevens and his poems. It's like this great jazz. I mean, you just go over and over and there's always new stuff in it and it's always delightful.
Mm. How about a luxury item?
My luxury item would be a bottle of Lagavulin single malt scotch.
Oh, man. Just one bottle?
Well, I mean, I get a whole crate, but Lagavulin is...
That's your Jones.
It's just, well, that and a good cigar, a Cuban one, if the laws allowed me to do that.
It's your island, man.
So a nice cigar, a bottle of Lagavulin, this music, Wallace Stevens poetry, and I'm home free.
You're perfect. Perfect. What are we going out with? Oh, Dr. Denny's Island. Dr. Denny. Yeah, you know Denny?
I don't know him personally. I've met him a couple times, but I don't know him at all in a personal way. But I've been listening to him since the 60s. He's I listen to him more now because, like me, he's got a dual career happening.
That's right.
He's a psychiatrist down here and then a phenomenal player. And this cut we're going to hear is from an album he did in the 60s called Zeitgeist. And the drummer is Greg Bridges' dad, Oliver Johnson.
Yeah.
It's Charlie Hayden on bass. No, it's Joe Halpin on bass on this cut. Sorry. There's different bass players on different cuts. And like a lot of the things we've been talking about, Tempest Fugit and the Art Tatum piece yesterday's, I mean, in just a couple minutes, it's just packed. So this is I Got Rhythm. Mm. And check it out.
Dave Bass, our guest out on the desert island. Michael Berman is the producer of Desert Island. He'll get Dave's list up on our website probably pretty quickly, kcsm.org. Check out Dave's site, too, davebassmusic.com. You were delightful.
Thank you. It was absolutely my pleasure.
I want to do more. Have a great weekend, everybody.
KCSM, San Mateo, San Francisco, Oakland, San Jose, K214CS Sonoma, and K216FV Concord, the Bay Area's jazz station.